Good morning. We are here for a wonderful anniversary today. Yesterday would have been the 100th birthday of Krafft Ehricke. He was born 100 years ago in Berlin, and as a child was very precocious, very bright, and very interested in mathematics, in science, and astronomy. And at the age of 12, he went to a movie theater in Berlin and saw a film that would change his life. This was Frau im Mond, the film, the movie that Hermann Oberth had been an advisor on, with a fantastic and unbelievably technically visionary view of mankind's moon mission. It was really at that time that Krafft Ehricke decided that this is what he would do with his life, would be to do the work to bring that vision into being. During the war, he was drafted into the German army, but he was very fortunate. He had filed 2 patents for new inventions in rocketry before the war. And so he was brought from the Eastern Front to Peenemünde and worked on the A4, which became the V2 rocket. So he was there in October of 1942 when the first man-made object reached the inner limits, just the edge of space. So at that time, it really had become very clear that the technology would be developed. There was no doubt mankind would master the technology to go into space. After the war, he came to the United States, worked for a little while with the team led by Wernher von Braun in Huntsville. They were designing a rocket that eventually would be the Saturn V to take man to the moon. But Krafft was always looking into the future. He was very confident that people would develop the technology. This would just be a matter of time. His concern was what we would be doing 50 years, 100 years, and most importantly, what was the reason? Why should we be going into space? In 1957, just a few months before the Soviet Union launched Sputnik and opened the space age, Krafft Ehricke wrote an article with a centerpiece was these 3 laws. He called them the 3 laws, the fundamental laws of astronautics. And this really was his philosophical framework, right? Not the technical details, not how to build a rocket, but the reasons why man should be going into space and the framework, the philosophical, the moral framework of what should guide him. So these were the 3 laws before the age of Sputnik. Nobody and nothing under the natural laws of this universe impose any limitations on man except man himself. And he could see 40 years in advance that the idea that man has no limits, that would be challenged. And of course, we saw that in the 1960s. Limits to growth came popular. But he could see in 1957 that you had to assert that there were no limits to man except man himself. Not only the Earth, but the entire solar system, and as much of the universe as he could reach under the laws of nature are man's rightful field of activity. Right? So we are certainly not limited to the Earth or even the space near the Earth, but the entire universe should be what we are exploring. And most importantly, by expanding through the universe, man fulfills his destiny as an element of life endowed with the power of reason and the wisdom of the moral law within himself. Right, so that this was not just a technical question, but a question of what is the nobility of man, what is the morality that mankind has. he described, and I'm just going to read a few quotes from him, why this was important. Why is space what embodies these three laws? Why not something else? He says, the concept of space travel carries with it enormous impact because it challenges man on practically all fronts of his physical and spiritual existence. The idea of traveling to other celestial bodies reflects the highest degree of independence and agility of the human mind. It lends ultimate dignity to man's technical and scientific endeavors, and above all, it touches on the philosophy of his very existence. This is not the way space travel is discussed very much today, but this is the framework within which excuse me, he saw the space age and its importance. In the 1930s, when he was just in his 20s, Krafft Ehricke started writing. And he started writing compositions and articles and papers that started in the future. In the 1930s, he wrote a piece that he just simply called To My Loving Mother. And it is about, again, this is in the 1930s, it's a story that starts in 1991 and recounts the voyage of an exploration mission to Venus. So this is 1991. No one, of course, knew what Venus was like, but he could imagine in his mind a scientific delegation, the crew, the maintenance people, but the astronomers, the scientists, maybe even biologists. People at that time thought there might be life on Venus. In 1948, he wrote something. Really quite extraordinary. This was written in English. This is 1948. This is 1 year after he came to the United States. 1 year. And the German space pioneers who came over after World War II were learning English by watching cowboy movies and sharing, 100 people sharing one English dictionary. But in 1948, he wrote this beautiful piece that you see on the screen, Expedition Ares. This starts 400 years in the future. Then looking back, what has happened over the 400 preceding years? And of course, he has visited all of the planets 400 years from now. Man has been and landed on all of the planets in the solar system. But he says, in the year 2000, is Expedition Ares, the first mission to manned mission to Mars. This is not entirely successful mission. They have all kinds of problems, encounters with asteroids. It's remarkable what he could envision the problems would be so many years before they would actually happen. If people remember the Apollo 13 mission, where they had an explosion on the way to the moon and we had to get them back, he has that kind of incident. All kinds of catastrophes, semi-catastrophes along the way. And he says, well, the first manned mission to Mars was not a success, but onwards. So again, this is 1948. What he was able to envision through the late 1940s and then 1950s was the full array of activities that space technology would open up to man. And if this is, I know, a little complicated, but in the 1960s, he put together this graph to show the different areas of science, technology, benefit to society, just from a very general standpoint. And you can see exploration lunar, because certainly we're going to go to the moon first, and then the entire solar system. You can see in the science areas, every branch of science, astronomy, of course, and space physics, but also chemistry and life sciences. So again, he was mapping in his mind and then putting forward for the space community what the potential of exploration should be, all the way from the very practical applications from Earth orbit, like what we have today, communications, all the way to exploration of the solar system. Okay, thank you. Venus, always very intriguing. Before we sent spacecraft out there, we really didn't know what Venus was like. And in 1955, Krafft Ehricke gave a lecture, as you can see him, in Copenhagen. This was at an international space conference. So he was already at that time mapping out exploration of the solar system. In Earth orbit, I just picked a couple of examples. This is a very charming one. This is a television interview that he did in 1966. He is showing Walter Cronkite, who was a major CBS television commentator from the very first NASA launch to practically the last one. Everyone in the United States knew Walter Cronkite. And here Krafft is showing him what an orbiting hospital could look like, that there would be a lot of benefits to people with different illnesses in microgravity. People with heart problems, burn victims, osteoporosis, various joint diseases, would really have a much easier time without this force of gravity that we all live with here. So he, again, was really looking at the whole array. Well, by the late 1960s, things in many places, and definitely in the United States, were changing. The culture was changing, the counterculture was coming in, the green movement, which at that point was the zero growth movement, propositions that mankind was limited, his thinking was limited, his resources were limited, and Krafft Ehricke was determined to intervene in this very destructive philosophical approach. And in 1971, he developed a picture for a concept, which he became very well known for, the extraterrestrial imperative. And what he was saying was, space exploration is not just a nice thing. It's not just a mission to here, a mission to there, or developing technology. He said, it's absolutely imperative. This is something we must do. In 1972, 73, he had written a book called The Extraterrestrial Imperative. And I just wanted to read a little bit of a foreword that he wrote for that book, because I think it encapsulates his philosophical approach. He says, a balanced attitude toward technology and industry, environment and ecology, is essential to our mental and spiritual development, hence vital to the preservation of our future. Otherwise, jungle and wilderness inside the mind and outside will regain their stranglehold on humanity. As starvation, disease, and depopulation stalk the earth, and the will to grow dies. Right, this was the alternative to the extraterrestrial imperative. Even with stagnant technology and industry, misery and poverty will engulf mankind. There's nothing such as stasis that you can have stagnation. Dedication to bare survival will destroy our social achievements, force nations, groups, and individuals into hostile isolation and shatter our civilization. This may start to sound familiar to us. This is a time to outgrow the parochial carryovers from past civilizations and intervening dark ages that burden the philosophy of our society and the recurring fear to grow. This is a time with our growing world that has expanded beyond planetary dimensions to grow with our growing knowledge and our growing responsibilities, which is the moral aspect. He says, Earth and world are no longer synonyms. We no longer lived in a closed world of one planet inside the womb of a biosphere. We must distinguish between what is uniquely terrestrial and what does not require the Earth. Our world is no more closed than it is flat. Our world is open to space, and its resources therewith are potentially limitless. Okay. And this is, I know this is very impossible to read, but for his extraterrestrial imperative book, Krafft Ehricke mapped it out for us. At the top half of the screen are what he sees as the consequences or the opportunities if there is growth. If we have a space program that takes us outside of the Earth to take advantage of all of the resources and the scientific breakthroughs awaiting us in our space exploration and development, just to mention a couple, of course, we'll have developments in technology and science, international cooperation, a limitless future, extraterrestrial industrialization, which I'll show you what that looks like, and a future for mankind outside of the Earth into the universe. Now, the second half, the bottom half of the diagram, are the consequences of what will happen to mankind if we don't have an open world, if we don't see space as our frontier to develop. And it's again, thinking of what the world looks like today, this is very prescient for him in 1971 to be able to see what the limits to growth and the closed world would lead to. Just to mention a couple of the things on the chart. Geopolitics, extreme poverty, mass starvation, wars, possibly nuclear war, social revolutions, ecological crises, and that the population would become death-oriented. I mean, could you have a better description of what we're facing today? So this is why he really, you know, devoted almost 20 years of his life to promoting the extraterrestrial imperative and speaking and doing television interviews and, lectures at universities to really try to counter what was happening in the 60s and through the 70s and to put mankind on a positive path. One of the questions I just wanted to quickly address is it's something that our organizers and people encounter talking to people in aerospace or just people that you meet at a post office about Krafft Ehricke. And while it's true that he passed away many years ago, very young, in 1984, people have not heard of him. They have heard of Wernher von Braun, I hope so. Certainly in the United States, he is a household word. People know, you know, that he was leading the development of the rocket that took Americans to the moon. And Krafft Ehricke knew Wernher von Braun. This is a photograph of both of them together with von Braun on the left, well, on your right, and Krafft. Why didn't Krafft Ehricke's name become a household word? Living by his own philosophy of the moral imperative of space exploration, Krafft Ehricke never compromised. He never bowed to any pressure of what was popular. And nuclear energy, space exploration, developing fusion power, saying that there were no limits to growth. By the late 1960s, this was not popular. He was not going to change, and he was not going to compromise. And therefore, by the late 1960s, he was not popular. He was not on television. He was not really before a large section of the American public. Right. So, and there have been criticisms of him by other scientists saying, well, he did the wrong thing. He would have been popular if he had been willing to compromise. And then we would not be celebrating Krafft Ehricke's birthday today because he would have been not important in history. But, it is something that we come up against in organizing. So I wanted to mention that. A wonderful tour of Germany, and I think you can see, I hope you can see enough of people's expression. You have Helga LaRouche and Krafft Ehricke on tour in November of 1981 in Germany, speaking at universities and giving lectures, here talking to members of the European Labour Party. And this was, really a way to bring his philosophy, his thinking, to Germany, where he started out. But his trip to Germany was very disturbing to him, and I'm sure to Helga LaRouche as well, because again, the political environment had changed. Right, you had the anti-nuclear movement, you had the Greens running rampant here, also in the United States, shutting down nuclear plants, resorting to violence when they thought that that would help them make their point. And this is a photograph of me talking to Krafft Ehricke before his presentation in New York City, when he returned from his trip to Germany. And I think you can see from the expression on his face, he's relating a very unhappy, disturbing experience. He opened his presentation on the extraterrestrial imperative, and I just want to read a quote because the way he said it is most important. He said, "It is a little bit disconcerting that the same shock troop kind of tactics stand at the end of one's life, as I have seen as a young man in Berlin in 1929, 1930, and 1931, right, the shock troops in the street. He continued, "The youth of West Germany and other nations have unfortunately been greatly misled. Today, if a person even talks about spaceflight or nuclear energy, then the ecopaths, the cultural pessimists, literally characterize this to be a provocation, and they do their utmost to prevent it. The police had to be called to prevent violence when students at a university venue tried to bar the speakers from entry," himself and Helga LaRouche. So you can imagine what kind of impact and effect this has. And he says, let's just take, for the sake of argument, let's just imagine that the view that the Greens have of limits to growth, let's say that that is correct. Are we thus to suffer indefinitely because technology could be misused? And then he says, "In 1979, of all things, in the year of the child of the United Nations, there were 12 million children who did not reach their first birthday. That's 50% more than all of the battle deaths in World War I. That is to say nothing of the suffering of those children before they died, and the suffering of the mothers who bore those children, just to see them die and not be able to feed them, to hear them cry day and night. This is unbelievable agony. So this was the way he framed the importance, juxtaposing what the consequences would be if you followed what the Greens were proposing. No technology, limits to growth, zero population, as compared to what the potential of mankind could be. The next one. Well, to get to his 50 years in the future, he developed a remarkably detailed and very beautiful picture of what the first steps had to be. And this was the industrial development of the moon. He described the lunar development as the extraterrestrialization of the human species. This would be our first step off the planet Earth to create a new civilization. And I'm just going to show a few pictures that he painted, many of them, and I'll indicate, he painted himself. It's nice to have paintings here in the conference room. Krafft Ehricke had the talent to not only develop the concepts, but also to visualize them. And so many of the paintings, this is one of his paintings. This is preparing runways on the moon for vehicles that would be coming to deliver supplies and crew. Next one. This is what he called a slide lander, which was an entirely new kind of vehicle. You had no atmosphere. The vehicles coming to the moon were not going to be airplanes, you know, that could land with wings. So he developed a whole new science to use the sand, the loose dirt on the moon, to be able to land, to slow down and land vehicles. Okay. The industrial development of the moon would absolutely take advantage of having nuclear energy. And again, I know this is hard to see, but these are his sketches of underground lunar mining. The moon has many materials that are useful, certainly oxygen, rare metals, titanium, alumina. So you would want to mine the moon, certainly. And you could do this in underground caverns, which is what he's pictured here, where you would have shaped nuclear charges, fission charges going off, and you would have the heat and the radiation to separate into constituent elements, the soil that you would be throwing in the cavity. So this would be underground nuclear mining. You would have a transportation system that initially would be taking material, components, habitats from the Earth to the moon as you were setting up the civilization there. Later, you would be taking the minerals and materials you were producing on the moon and probably bringing them not back to the Earth's surface, but certainly to Earth's orbit, and later to Mars and wherever else you were going in the solar system. Again, nuclear, this is a nuclear-powered freighter that Krafft Ehricke himself painted. Today, people talk about going to the moon and sending two people a little habitat, a little igloo for them to live in. That was not Krafft Ehricke's picture of a city on the moon. This is Selenopolis. This is a city with hundreds of thousands of people. This is not a few people, you know, crouching in closed quarters, huddling together, which is what's being proposed today. This is powered by fusion energy. You see on the left, tokamaks under construction. You can see, I hope you can see it, it's probably too light. Well, under the dome is the city, of course, and then you have a magnetically levitated transportation system, hard to see, but going around the outside of the city. And I want to show you what the inside would look like. This is summer in Selenopolis. Again, this is not going to be a few people, you know, living in a tent. This is going to be like cities on Earth. And it will replicate what people need, even for recreation. These are people relaxing after a tennis game and living life, doing their scientific work, putting on spacesuits, going out exploring, supervising the mining operations, but they also need to relax. And the last one of Selenopolis is winter, and an ice skating rink. You see on one side, on the left side, is a building which is the Hall of Astronauts. You're going to have museums, concert halls. In addition, in the far distance is your garden. This is where your food is grown, your crops. So you have many different kinds of environments, weather systems, climate. So the moon would be the first step. This would be your extraterrestrial foothold. It will be your manufacturing center to be able to send people out to the rest of the solar system. You're also going to be developing, not just on the moon, but even in Earth orbit, the capability to do that. Now, this is a drawing. It's also hard to see. It's just a black and white line drawing that he did. And this he called Astropolis, again, the opolis meaning a city, the astro being in space. This would be a city in space orbiting the Earth. We know what the International Space Station looks like today, and it's a pretty good size, you know, weighs 1 million pounds, can accommodate 7 astronauts. But this is not a space station. This is a city in space, again, with hundreds of thousands of people. And this would be the largest Earth orbiting system. And it would be, I just want to read for 1 minute his description of Astropolis. A new branch of psychology, exopsychology, and of sociology, exosociology, will evolve, because this is going to be a self-sufficient city. The transition to life beyond Earth is very profound. Nobody can predict at this time what the ultimate outcome of the adjustments will be in what may be the greatest socio-psychological challenge faced in human history. He said that, the things that will be contained here will be, of course, living accommodations, growing food, and other things that you need. Also, a space university. Really, the first step towards separation from Earth. And he says the Space University is organized for extensive and long-term utilization of the orbital environment for basic and applied research. On Earth, university laboratories can simulate many environments, but they cannot simulate subterrestrial or zero gravity conditions. So you will have the university in orbit to be able to start to simulate for people what it will be like to go out and to live off the Earth. And this, of course, Astropolis will be built when lunar industrialization is already underway. So some of the materials that you will use to build Astropolis will come from the moon. And finally, what is the end point here? for mankind to develop another Earth. If you look at the comparative size between the Earth and what he called an astrocell, they're really about the same size. So this is a duplication, if you will, a duplicate of the Earth with all of the same facilities, resources, but it's not a station that's going to stay in orbit around the Earth. It is going to finally cut the bounds of Earth with a propulsion system, and it's just going to go off on its own. This is really a very challenging concept. He says, androcells will be spun off from the mother planet as a self-sufficient society, no longer tied to the Earth or even to the moon, but free to travel the solar system. He says it's mobile, seeks other resources, it's going to visit all the other planets, and finally man will have cut the umbilical cord to Earth. So this was the final, and of course nothing would limit you either to the solar system. If you have your own fusion propulsion system, you can actually gather the fuel, the helium, the oxygen, what you need for the rocket propulsion, the fusion propulsion system, you can do that on your travels and just go. So this would be the evolution that you would see. And then he says he envisions this process as the outlook for the evolution of the universe in the next 30 billion years. Right, that once man is free to just go, mankind will determine the evolution of the universe for 30 billion years. And last, okay. This is just very simply a summary of the whole picture. All right, starting from the left-hand side with the lunar materials processing, manufacturing, extraterrestrialization, going up from there to Astropolis in the center, this huge city in Earth orbit, then going on the left up to Selenopolis, the city on the moon, lunar colonization, then the androcell. The androcell is free to go to Mars. He has a Mars androcell, an asteroid belt, a Jovian, right, to Jupiter, and you're just free to go. I just want to finish with one very beautiful quote, which I know was a challenge to translate into German. Well, it's poetry, as far as I'm concerned. At the time of his death, Krafft Ehricke had been working very intensively for the previous 10 years through the 70s, and he passed away in 1984 and was ill for that whole previous year. So for 10 years, towards the end of his life, he was working intensively on the lunar industrialization, because these were the steps he really was actively promoting to be implemented right away. There was no reason to wait to do it. And he wrote a book called The Seventh Continent, The Industrialization and Settlement of the Moon. And he describes the moon as the prime model of developing a new world at the outset of androspheric expansion. He says there are several reasons why you would do that. He says the moon is our partner in this double planet system, only 2.5 to 3 flight days away, less time than it takes an oil tanker to get from the Persian Gulf to New England. The moon is a potential source of raw materials and a suitable place for materials processing. and for establishing the first extraterrestrial biosphere. The surface area almost equals that of the Americas, which lends itself enough gravity for human comfort and plant growth. He also says that the moon is a new world of great beauty. Selenians, those living in Selenopolis, live truly on the shores of interplanetary ocean. They will travel with ease between the 1/6 surface gravity of the moon and the weightlessness of circumlunar orbiting outposts, and later between their world and those of Mars, asteroids, and the moons of Jupiter and Saturn. The Selenians indeed live in a cosmically open world. I see a polyglobal, three-dimensional civilization. In retrospect, its foundations were laid in the twilight of the past millennium by those who understood the magnificent call of the extraterrestrial imperative. But there were some among them who did not have the capacity for understanding that their world reaches to the stars. And so they rooted and burrowed into the ground. They regressed, whining and shouting slogans. Fearful to grow, they atrophied to a barren stump on a clump of earth and became stillbirths of the biosphere. I think we know some people who think this way. In a miserable world of stagnation, poverty, and backwardness, they may indeed manage to trigger the ultimate catastrophe of releasing nuclear energy in an entropic holocaust, but this is not preordained. Instead, the new humanity, Homo sapiens extraterrestris, will sail on a new course into the open world of limitless growth, negentropically and steady as you go. Finally, Lyndon LaRouche, who we are honored to have here today, developed a concept a number of years ago called the simultaneity of eternity. This is a very, very important concept, I think, for us today in this current situation. The value, the importance of Krafft Ehricke's work is not dependent upon what he did in the past. It is completely dependent upon what we do in the future. Now, what we do is going to define and give meaning to his work and his position that he occupies in history. And I think that's really, we can see, I think, very clearly the situation today. And you look at Krafft Ehricke's graph of what a closed world could bring the world to, and we see it all around us. And many years ago, he gave us the pathway to a different world. Thank you.